Hello and welcome to another edition of Surviving Scientology Radio. This is your host, Jeffrey Augustine. We are available online at survivingscientologyradio.com or at Surviving Scientology on YouTube. Today we have with us Steve Hall, the owner of Scientology-Cult.com, one of the best websites out there. Highly recommend you read it. Steve was in Sea Org for a long time. Steve, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, Jeff.
Steve, just how long were you in the Church of Scientology?
Well, I got in 79, left in 2003, so I was in the Sea Org about 20 years, and before that I was on staff in various other organizations.
Yeah, well, Steve, you were in a pretty key marketing job in the Sea organization, weren't you?
Yeah, I was. I was the senior writer for the church, which means the copywriter traditionally in advertising is the person that comes up with the ideas for the various campaigns. So the copywriter is normally the idea person, and that's, you know, you don't have a marketing campaign until you have what the idea is, you know, the creative strategy is what we call it. So yeah, I had an opportunity for several years to set the direction for the church's marketing, and was doing it successfully until that got shit canned by Miscavige.
I understand. What are some of the projects you worked on? What are some of the marketing campaigns?
Oh, I worked on a bunch of Dianetics stuff. Did the largest campaign for Scientology itself in 1997 and 1998. That included like 28 television ads, scores of print ads and all kinds of stuff. And two of the books that we actually did ads for became national bestsellers through Ingram's Booksellers, you know, on trade lines.
Really?
Yeah. That was two of Hubbard's, you know, old Scientology books, Fundamentals of Thought, and another one called New Slant on Life. Now, I found out, though, after spending all and doing all that work and putting all this effort into the whole thing, that the whole thing was a farce anyway, because after about 2 months of running the campaign, which there was enough ads there to go on for 2 to 3 years easily. And, Miscavige just decided that the girl that was running the thing named Manu Spencer, that she was, quote, out ethics. That means, you know, Scientology parlance. That means the not being ethical in some way. It's just a complete generality, really. And so she was banished, and all the finances to the campaign were abruptly severed after 2 months. And this was a huge, huge campaign that had been put together. And the whole thing just ended right there. And then I realized that at that point, it began to dawn on me that the whole purpose for all these, quote, dissemination campaigns, they call them in the church, and they're all designed for like public outreach. The real reason was simply to elicit donations from Scientologists. And that was really what was going on. It was, in other words, 100% corrupt, 100% criminal, 100% fake.
Well, would you say that it's a bait and switch? They claim they're reaching the public, disseminating, but they're just fundraising.
That's exactly right.
And Steve, this raises a great point. The church endlessly raises money for anything and everything. And what's so confounding, I think the public really doesn't understand, but they're beginning to. The Church of Scientology exists, in my opinion, solely and only to raise money.
Right.
And it seems like the church of fundraisingology, and it's become a runaway machine. So the logic doesn't make sense to me as a businessman. If I create a campaign to sell something, I'll run it through to the end.
Right.
And, you know, you design a campaign, you have your key people, you execute because you do want to raise brand awareness, sell products. But if DM David Miscavige at a whim can RPF someone and close down a campaign, does that mean he hit his fundraising target and has really no interest?
Well, you know, it's like the reality doesn't match the illusion of what's being done. In other words, on the surface, and actually earlier, I mean, when I started, you know, in Scientology in 1979, things were very different. They weren't perfect then, but they were almost as different from what it is today as night versus day. In other words, back then there were no donation campaigns, just straight where, you know, give us your money and you get nothing in return. That was the church only sold services and courses. That's it. So today, now they hardly sell any services now. It's just, well, give us your money. Why? Because we said so. And if you don't, then you'll get in trouble. And so somewhere along the line, obviously, in fact, I remember there was a lady who worked under me in the late 1990s. Her name was Becky, and she had at one point been her profession was in getting donations from people and grants. Okay, so she had brought up the point like, hey, you know, we could be getting, you know, government grants and so forth. And they started on this whole idea of, wow, you know, free money. And you know, the IAS, which also didn't exist at the time when I joined, but started in 1984. In fact, I was at the international headquarters in 1984 when the senior executives were working on this very campaign, to actually writing all the foundational issues for the IAS, which is the International Association of Scientologists. And, you know, they're actually in Guillaume Leserve's name, which is, he was the executive director international. But of course, the one calling the shots was David Miscavige. He was the one, you know, approving and authorizing and directing exactly what needed to happen. So this thing grew, and it became a source. It became a complete cash cow and a source for free money. And they just added more and more people on there and found that, you know, you can get any amount of money. Just add more, you know, more salespeople there, and they just keep on getting the money. And then I think he eventually figured out that, what do we need all this, you know, messing with new people for? Because really, the amount of money that he could make from one Tom Cruise or one John Travolta or one, you know, rich person dwarfed the amount of money that could be produced along more legitimate lines. And so they just said, well, the hell with all that, or he did, really. And just has now, you know, the wart on the toe has got to be bigger than the whole rest of the body. And now the IAS is the only primary function of the church. It is 100% a donation organization. And they just pay lip service to actually doing anything for anybody at this point.
Steve, IAS fascinates me. I'm researching it for my blog, the ScientologyMoneyProject.com. Yeah. The International Association of Scientologists is the membership organization of the Church of Scientology. In other words, the Church of Scientology does not have members. Right. You cannot join the. And I'll go back one step further. There is no such entity called the Church of Scientology. Right. And what you do is you join a membership organization called International Association of Scientologists. Now, the IAS in and of itself cannot do anything. It's an unincorporated association. Therefore, it created the International Association of Scientologist Administrations. That's the operating arm.
Right.
And so you get the Sea Org, which is an unincorporated religious order. And on the other side, there's the IES members, public Scientologists.
Yes.
And they meet in a building owned by the Church of Scientology International, or Flag Service Organization, or the Free Winds.
Yes.
So the Church of Scientology owns the buildings, the ship in which delivery takes place. It's given by a member of an unincorporated religious order to a public member of an unincorporated membership organization, and the money flows up lines.
Right.
Now, this points to something that's gone on in the church. It takes a lot of work to deliver an hour of auditing. You have a lot of people involved with folders, you know, case supervision, qual, on and on and on, right?
Right, exactly. And liability in case they didn't like their service or later want their money back. That's a huge factor right there.
Yeah, so if I'm David Miscavige, if I just take free money for doing nothing, I mean, that makes a lot more sense. Well, right. I have a bunch of people who have cases going on, and you know, you got to have people go type three, maybe even especially after Lisa McPherson. It's like, why are we going to engage in auditing? And compounding that matter, the church punishes auditors. You know how the rule goes, if you were the last auditor to have audited someone who, you know, blew or left or spoke out.
Oh, yeah.
The auditor's crucified.
Right, absolutely. Which is another factor that keeps people there, because they don't want to get their, you know, maybe the one or two people that are they've actually felt, you know, a kindred sort of connection with, and maybe they try to help them. They don't want to actually get that guy, you know, crucified when they leave. But there's not really much you can do about that. So eventually people just leave anyway.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing. So you were there for when the IAS started.
Yes.
And it begins to slowly take over the church.
Yeah, Adient was in his office writing the issues, and everybody was scrambling around. This was the thing that was happening in the summer of 1984 when I first went to the INT Base.
Now, who's the EDN?
That's Guillaume Leserve,
That means
Executive Director International. So he's supposed to be the top guy in the Church of Scientology Corporation, because David Miscavige is not in the Church of Scientology. He's in the Religious Technology Center and so forth. So
Guillaume is supposed to be the senior most official in the Church of Scientology International.
Yeah, of course, now he's just a broken piece of mud today.
Oh, yeah, he's...
he's completely broken down.
Been through hell.
Right.
And you're doing a secondary role. I mean, your role becomes secondary. Instead of disseminating the technology, selling books, et cetera, they just take the program apart.
Yeah, it was really just a matter of, it's just manipulating and manipulation. He was manipulating me as a creative individual to do marketing for him, which wasn't actually even intended to actually be used other than to show all these wealthy Scientologists at events, which are completely illegal also per what LRH said. You're not supposed to have these kinds of events, and they didn't used to. But these, you know, wealthy Scientologists are shown, oh, we're going to do all these TV ads. It's going to be our biggest marketing campaign ever in history. And here's our new campaign. It's know yourself, know life. That was actually the marketing slogan that I came up with for this particular campaign that we're talking about. And in fact,
so you created Know Yourself, Know Life.
Yeah. That was one of my many different contributions to, you know, my whole thing really started much earlier than that. And it's like, you know, to me, the problem with the church was it was a cult. And, you know, anybody that couldn't see that was, I don't know, living in some other world. But as a marketing person, I always thought, well, that's the obvious problem here. How are you going to get people in when you're a cult? So you've got to stop being a cult. So I tried to do that. That's what I set out to do, is I tried to do that and to basically decultify Scientology, because I could really see no inherent reason why it needed to be a cult, other than it was obviously can somehow become that. And so that was what I was trying to do through marketing, and it actually started to take off. But when people started sending me fan mail for all the changes that were happening, and Miscavige heard about that, that was the end of my, you know, marketing career in the church. I got transferred over into, you know, head up script writing, and from there things just went downhill.
What was the first crack in, you know, the reality system? What was the first crack in your reality when you said, I have to leave the Sea Org and get out of here?
Well, that's a great question. Really, it happened in 1990. At that time, I was over all the Dianetics marketing in every organization around the world. Jeff Hawkins was heading up the Dianetics marketing on what we call trade lines, in other words, through, you know, public bookstores and so forth. But internally, inside the churches, I was over all Dianetics marketing internationally. So every country, every language, every organization, every mission, every, you know, group that was under me. And I had been to a meeting in Clearwater where we had a lot of people from countries like, you know, Peru and, you know, the Eastern bloc nations, which had recently, you know, sort of been able to, you know, participate in the world in a new way, with the fall of the USSR and that kind of thing. Anyway, a lot of those people came and they said, hey, you know, there's a problem there, because the basic book of Dianetics and Scientology, which is called Dianetics, which is supposed to be the way that we, you know, were intended to reach out to new people and get them interested. The price of that book in some of these countries, you know, we're talking about third world countries, cost the equivalent of the average wage earner's monthly income to buy one book. Yeah, because by the time they were exported from the United States with export and, you know, import duties and VAT, you know, VAT taxes, and plus they were way expensive to start with. And when you get through with the exchange rate of dollars to pesos or dollars to whatever it was, yeah, they were. So what these people were doing is they would pool their money and buy one book and then tear pages out of it and pass them around in a circle. And so you'd get 10 pages to read, and you read those, and when you were done, you'd pass them to the next guy, and you'd get the next 10 pages from the guy before you. And that's how they were sharing. A whole community of people would have to share one book. So this was like, I thought this was the most insane thing ever. If the purpose of Scientology, which it supposedly was, is to reach out to new people and help as many people as possible, well, this is directly blocking that mission. So I put together.
It certainly is.
Yeah. So
and just to interject, this is a wealthy religious cult.
Right.
And one question that's always asked: why don't they just give away copies of Dianetics or news? Why don't they just give it away? You know, because the Gideon Bible Society has given away millions and millions of Bibles. And this is what I don't get, Steve. L. Ron Hubbard gifted his entire intellectual property to the Church of Scientology. A point I keep making is, why must the church make money on a gift? If it was a gift, you should give away the gift in turn. And the Jehovah's Witnesses have a very large, gigantic publishing infrastructure. It's in Brooklyn and other places. The Jehovah's Witnesses, contrary to whatever the Church of Scientology wants to say, the Jehovah's Witnesses have a much larger in-house printing capability. It would dwarf anything. The Church of Scientology is dwarfed by what the Jehovah's Witnesses do. And their whole point, as you know, they go door to door and they give away pamphlets, or they ask for a dime or a dollar. You know, it's just low-cost dissemination.
Right.
This has always bothered me, even on little copies of The Way to Happiness. The average price the church tries to get is $4.25. It works out to that.
Yeah.
And the money just keeps amassing.
Right.
So what you're saying is they expected to sell a book that costs a month's wages in a third world country?
Yeah, they were just pricing them at an insanely high rate. And so what I did is I put together a whole submission on how we could get the books printed locally in every one of these countries, how much it would cost, how to get them printed on cheap paper, just like the other books that are printed, because, you know, every one of these countries, they have paperback books. And and I put together this whole, you know, proposal on how to get this done and bring the price of the books, our most basic book, down to where it'd be affordable for people and wouldn't be a barrier. Okay. David Miscavige shot that down in flames and basically told, his brother, Ronnie, who was in charge of all marketing at the time, that I was trying to degrade, L. Ron Hubbard's works. So at that point, I was staggered, because I realized that was the point in 1990 it was in the summer, that I realized that David Miscavige is what the church calls a suppressive person. In other words, he's a sociopath. I didn't know the word sociopath back then, but that's the closest thing that the church has, you know, to that. I think it's descriptive of the same type of person, a person with just no moral regard for anybody but themselves. That the church was being in the hands of a suppressive person, was being run by a suppressive. And as far as I could tell, nobody in the church, nobody at the international base seemed to have a clue about this except for me. And you know what? I didn't know what to do. that is almost, it's pretty overwhelming, because then I realized I was trapped at this place. And because I had a wife there and I could just leave, but then what about her? So
yeah.
I decided, I got to tell her, what's going on, because we had just gotten married 2 years before and I was in love with her still. So I told her, I said, the problem with the international, headquarters here is that the senior execs are intentionally using fear and intimidation. They're misusing the subject of ethics to create an atmosphere of fear and intimidation. And within days of telling her that, I was suddenly told that I was going to the RPF, which was the Rehabilitation Project Force, which is basically the Scientology gulag, or your mind control, reprogramming, thing. I was basically sent off 90 miles away to Los Angeles, separated from my wife, and I had to put on a black boiler suit. I couldn't speak to anybody. I had no money. I literally went down there with like $3 in my pocket. I didn't even have a toothbrush or a towel or a bar of soap. I had to, borrow from other people. And, it was pretty rough. And I would have left then. And I did really think hard about leaving. The only thing was I would have had to leave my wife, and I still loved her. So that's part of the
emotional blackmail the church has over people. Also, you mentioned the financial problem. Look, you're sent to the RPF. You don't have a towel or a bar of soap.
Right.
And no toiletries, no toothbrush. One thing I want to draw our listeners' attention to, jail inmates, prison inmates are treated better than people on the RPF.
No question about that. They got more rights.
Well, one thing that's shocking in the Church of Scientology's response to Lawrence Wright's book, they put up a hate website on Larry.
Yeah.
And after he wrote his book, and they actually, and this is what I don't understand about the church. Maybe you could help me. Larry made a comment in his book that more money is spent feeding prisoners than is spent on Sea Org members eating.
Right.
And this, the church was really stung by this. They're trying to argue that they spend more money than is spent in prisons.
Oh, gosh.
Because I think Mark Headley said there's Sea Org members are fed like, on a dollar a day.
Yeah, that's right.
And in California, at least in 2012, it was $3.41 for a prisoner per day. You can't eat on that.
Right.
And so you're already starving. And as Lawrence Wright makes evident in his book, Going Clear, which, by the way, is a great book. If you haven't read it, it's Going Clear, Scientology, Hollywood, and the Prison of Belief. Larry mentions this. The church specifically rebuts them. They don't like it when their deeds are exposed. So you are RPF without a bar of soap, a towel, or a toothbrush.
Yeah, and really given no reason. It was not explained at all why I was even going to the RPF. Basically just that I was, had created in turbulation, which was means like created some, it upset somebody, but they didn't say who. And
had your wife written a knowledge report on you?
Well, I finally realized that long after the fact that's exactly what happened. She had basically, because she was in the ethics section, the very section which was involved in this sort of subversion of people and mind control. And that section was run directly by RTC. In other words, it was Marty's area, and his direct junior, who was Chris, basically RTC people were in there all the time, and they ran everything because that's where they got all the dirt on people, and that's how they basically kept people in line, was through.
Well, let me ask you this: is RTC the really the religious thought police within the church?
Well, it's
or is everyone the thought police?
Well, it's kind of like Nazi Germany. I mean, I guess I hate that's probably a terrible comparison.
Call it then, but Soviet Russia.
But, yeah, but I mean, even in these other places, and you know, there are actually many examples of a sociopath getting in control of a religious group or a corporation. It's happened so many times. And if you look back through history, it's happened to nations and countries time after time. And, you know, of course, there's a big effort generally to rat out your neighbors, you know, if somebody is, you know, if you get, you know, that just because I always say, look, if so-and-so is doing something wrong and we find out you knew about it, then you're going to be toast also.
Oh, you'll be punished.
For their crimes along with them. So then you find out, you know, your next door neighbor was secretly planning to run away with his family and cross the border. And then when he does, and then they find out you knew about it, or maybe they just, you know, just decide you should have known about it and shoot you anyway. So everybody gets frantic about turning everybody else in. And I'm sure that my ex-wife at the time, I know that's what happened, is she probably was, you know, troubled because I said this. And, you know, she was looking back on it, you know, just didn't have the, I guess, cojones to stand up to this type of stuff. And she probably, you know, went to somebody trusting, said, look, I'm, you know, what are you worried about? Or what are you, how come you're, you know, you're not, you know, yeah, doing as well. What's up with you, you know, Sue? And she, you know, they put her on the meter. I'm sure she probably blurted it all out or wrote up in a knowledge report that, you know, her husband had told her this. And that is what interpolated, you know, upset, you know, the top people, which would have been, you know, David Miscavige, Mark Yeager, Guillaume, all the people who were involved in this subterfuge. And therefore, I got, you know, shit canned.
Yeah, it's like, how dare you have thoughts against the group?
Exactly.
And really, when you describe being RPF or having a thought and voicing a thought, it demonstrates two things. One, in the Church of Scientology, the church is always the third person in the marriage bed.
Right.
You can imagine a husband and wife laying there at night in bed having pillow talk. Well, you might as well put the church right in between man and wife.
Right.
Because I've known too many people who've, you know, had been knowledge reports written by their spouse or usually ex-spouse. Because it is an atmosphere of fear.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, the Church of Scientology promotes to the world that it has effective solutions for living, freedom, spiritual freedom, higher spiritual states, blah, blah, blah. But in reality, it's a very much a thought-policed internal security spying. The contents of your PC folders can be used against you.
Right.
And the church is just, the Church of Scientology is such a train wreck. It really is. And it engages in malicious behavior. And at the root of it, one of the key problems that I'd like you to talk about is the massive brain drain out of the Church of Scientology beginning in the 90s forward, the loss of their best and brightest people.
Right.
Like you.
Oh, thanks. Well, yeah, there's a couple of things, and in fact, let me real quick tie up a couple of loose ends, and then we'll come back to the brain drain and this weird duality in the church where they've got, you know, supposedly got these great tools, but on the other hand, they're vicious and destroy, you know, marriage after marriage after marriage. First of all, I just wanted to mention back when we were talking about the formation of the IAS, one of the big factors also was the liability of what they call advanced payments. In other words, starting in the mid-1980s, I was only at the INT Base for about 24 hours, really less than 24 hours when I thought, you know, this place is the most insane madhouse on the face of Earth, and I'm getting out of here. And because it was, you know, it was nothing like anything I'd seen before, you know, at any church or organization. I mean, these people were just nuts. To my mind, they didn't use Scientology at all. They didn't even seem to know what it was or understand it. So I went out to Clearwater to their, you know, to the what they call FLAG, which is their largest delivery organization in the world, and became an executive there right away. And while I was there, FLAG started doing really well, and they started getting being able, you know, their income shot up from a couple hundred thousand dollars a week to over a million. And this was huge. But so many people were paying for services because what they started doing was just pushing what they called hard selling. There was this crush sales techniques on people. They were getting people to mortgage their homes and max out their credit cards. And they were getting so much money coming into the church. And what that did is it created tremendous liability of the advance payments, because those were, by policy, refundable. So if a person put down $100,000 for some future services and services for his kids and his wife, and then if they didn't actually end up taking those services, they were welcome to take the money back. And that could not happen. So there was a big problem with, what about these advanced payments, what they call APs, advanced payments, because of the financial liability that they represented. And that's why they started going to straight donations through the IAS, because that money is not refundable. So
no, it's not. And you make an excellent point. When you donate to the IAS, you sign an agreement saying, I agree that this is not refundable.
Exactly. And that is why they're doing it, because it's not refundable. And plus, there's no liability. I mean, they don't even have to deliver anything. It's just, you know, wham, bam, thank you, ma'am. Give us some more.
Well, yeah, it's free money. And in exchange, you get a certificate or a trophy.
Right.
Which is pretty meaningless, you know.
Totally. It's 100% meaningless. And actually, it's not meaningless. You know, the bigger the trophy, the stupider you are. That's the meaning of it, right?
Well, okay. So. Well, you have to wonder. Here in Los Angeles, there was an OT, Richie Acanto, who donated. He was associated with Survival Insurance.
Right.
He donated $10 million to the IAS.
Right.
Then Richie went bankrupt. This is all in public documents. I'm not disclosing anything that's not public.
Right.
You know, but that $10 million, I don't know if it was a pledge or how much he actually paid, but the point is that $10 million could have saved his business.
Of course.
And when I made public the IRS 990-Ts that showed $1.5 billion in book value spread among three entities.
Yeah.
Folks, if you're listening and still in the church, they have plenty of money. There is no emergency or crisis. The planet will not get cleared if you mortgage your house. The planet is not being cleared. In fact, what's being cleared are bank accounts of Scientology parishioners. That's what's being cleared with speed and straight up and vertical expansion, or is people's money, people's bank accounts, their credit card. Okay, so to get out of the liability for advance payment, because if you contractually take $100,000, like you say, you have to deliver $100,000 in services. One of the screwball things of church finance policy is the very week you take in that $100,000, it goes up lines and it's gone.
Right.
And so the delivery organization like Flag is on the hook for $100,000 in delivery of services.
Right.
And so if they deliver in the future, they're not going to get paid for that.
That's right.
And that creates a problem.
Yeah.
Okay,
sociopaths are notorious for shortcutting things. So why go to all the trouble to have to deliver services when we can just go ask for money? No, demand money. No, threaten them until they give us the money. So that's what the church does now, because it's in the hands of a sociopath. Another point you asked about, though, was this sort of duality about Scientology supposedly having all the tools to help people and help marriages and all this. But when you look at their actual statistics of the number of, you know, marriages that, you know, how, what happens with an actual marriages, and you're like, man, it's like divorce disaster, you know, city. I mean, they've destroyed more lives than they've put together. And what is going on? And I had a comment on that, if you'd like to hear it.
Please. Yeah, please.
Well, you know, in studying, you know, when I originally, in 2008, I started, you know, working on doing the research basically that resulted in ScientologyCult.com. Which, by the way, we get about 5,000 hits per day, every single day, which is a huge amount of traffic. It just keeps going up and up and up. And if you,
it's a great website.
Yeah, and if you Google the words David Miscavige, that website is on page one. And if you Google the word Scientology, it's normally on page one or two. So that's pretty cool.
That's great.
But you know, it was obvious that Miscavige was a bad apple, and something had to be done. And the biggest issue that I saw and the most effective way to fight it was to basically, I mean, there were various people that were standing up and you know, like Anonymous was doing a lot, you know, to call foul on these criminal actions. But where were the Scientologists? Where were Scientology's own people, you know, who should be standing up and doing something about this, or at least speaking out? And there were none. There was nobody that was doing that. I mean, zero. So I thought, this is what we've got to do, because every time they have a non-Scientologist stand up and talk about the church would just counter that by saying, oh, he's a religious bigot. He's just persecuting us. He's a nut. And
exactly.
And that was
yep.
very effective, because people think, as well, yeah, he might be. I mean, he's certainly not a Scientologist. How would he know? And so I started this website designed to get Scientologists to stand up as Scientologists and say, hey, this place is full of corruption, criminality, and abuse, and here's what I've witnessed myself. And that's what made it so effective, and because the church had nothing. They had no comeback for that. They had no defense. And that's why I did it. You know, this is pretty sophisticated marketing, in actual fact, but that's kind of my specialty. I learned marketing while inside the church. I didn't actually learn it from the church. I learned it from some advertising guys that were not Scientologists, but I learned it while I was in the church, and that was a hell of a place to try to use marketing, because it was, you know, a worst case scenario. So I got very good at having to figure out how to solve the worst case scenarios that there were. And so that's what I've been doing since then. Now, outside
the
church.
That's fascinating. If you know, I guess if you know how to market Scientology, I mean, that's, you know how to market anything.
Exactly.
And you learn marketing not because of Scientology, but despite being in the church. No, your Scientology-cult.com is a sophisticated site, and it's got excellent content, essays by former members. And one thing that the listeners should know, people inside the church, they're programmed to tune out anything out there on the WOG internet.
Yeah.
Haters, bigots, lunatic fringe of the internet, you know, et cetera.
Yeah.
So they're programmed to tune out. But when you began your site, and then Marty and Mike, people inside the church were forced to listen.
Yeah.
Absolutely forced to listen, because it was their own, you know, it was former members of the church speaking out.
Well, there was a big, you know, there was a lot of silent people who wanted to do something, but there had been no platform for them to do anything. Mine was really the first, because mine, you know, I started before Marty, long before Mike did, and really, you know, in actual fact, they used, I mean, I was in common with them. I told them, look, this is how you do it. And they emulated what Scientology Cult was doing. Scientology Cult set the direction and actually introduced the formula for here's how you do something online. And before that, Marty was simply going to, you know, I'm not trying to put Marty down. He's done more for bringing, needed correction of the church than probably any other human being has ever done. But you
make a good point. No, your site was sophisticated. I remember when it came out, and because it takes a lot of different types of websites, and Marty was doing something very focused and necessary. Now, you were doing.
Well, Marty was going to the media. He was working with the St. Pete Times. And then later he put up a one page note that basically said he was there, and he, you know, if anybody needed help, you know, give him a call. And then when Scientology Cult took off, and he commented to me, said, this, you've really got something here. I mean, I'm getting so much feedback from everybody about ScientologyCult.com. And so then he started a blog. You know, of course, I explained why this was the correct strategy, is to go use the internet. That was my angle from the beginning, because, you know, I never really worked that much with the media, and media is kind of hard to control because they tend to cut everything down into a soundbite. In other words, you talk for 3 hours and what gets used is 15 seconds. That's literally, and then they'll repeat the 15 second statement 4 times and that's your 5 minutes on CNN. Whereas, you know, one of the things that led me to start Scientology Cult too was I actually called the FBI, contacted the FBI, and I said, hey, you know, here's the thing. I left the Church of Scientology They, you know, they got my wife, they got this, they got that. And, you know, the guy on the phone, he was very nice, but he said, well, you know, frankly, I don't know how to put this, but this, it's so unbelievable, you know, to hear about this. And I go, you know, that is really the problem. It's so fantastic. It's so incredible. It's so huge, you know, that this could, something like this could be going on in America. You know, there where somebody's going to take your car keys and you're back behind razor wire fences with cameras and security guards and even a freaking guard dog, and you can't escape in the middle of the desert, and that this could be going on is hard to grasp. And so I thought, you know, what we're going to have to do is have is put together a website where you've got the actual testimony from all these different people who were there, put that all in one place, and then from that, the FBI would be able to see, wow, now we're starting to get it, because all these stories, they all weave together and they all corroborate each other. You know, whereas when you're telling lies, they never corroborate, you know, it all fall apart and break apart in the details, because you can't make a platform based on lies actually fit together.
No, and you make an excellent point. Scientology founder L. Ron Hubbard said, quote, incredulity of our data and validity. This is our finest asset and gives us more protection than any other single thing.
Right.
If certain parties thought we were real, we would have infinitely more trouble.
Right.
Without a public incredulity, we would never have gotten as far as we have, unquote. And so I have talked to law enforcement. Many, many people have talked to law enforcement, different federal agencies, local agencies.
Yeah.
And there is a certain amount of incredulity, law enforcement rolling their eyes saying, oh, that can't be true. You can't lock people up, interrogate them, pay them, you know, $8 a week or pay them nothing, rice and beans. So there is a certain amount of incredulity. And this is where the Internet has became such an important tool to expose the Church of Scientology.
Right.
And the Internet is asymmetrical. The church can't control it. It tries to. In fact, right now, Steve, my wife Karen's Surviving Scientology YouTube channel is under a cyber attack by unknown agents.
Right.
I suspect the Office of Special Affairs. Why? Because her channel has been so very successful.
Well, yeah, who else would care?
Exactly. No one has a reason to attack a YouTube channel on Scientology. It is of no interest outside of people who are interested in Scientology, which is a considerable audience, but we have 2.1 million views, and now suddenly this attack. Anyway, back to what you were talking about. You began ScientologyCult.com as a way to reach Scientologists, and it was very successful.
Well, and also FBI and the world at large, which is really, when you say Internet, we're really talking about the human race, you know, everybody on this planet.
Absolutely.
Bringing them to do something about the church is like going and getting your big brother, because, you know, you couldn't handle the bully yourself. So, hey, you know what? I'm going to go get my big brother. Oh, yeah. It happens to be 8 billion people, and they're going to kick your ass.
Yeah.
That's sort of part of the concept, too. And eventually, you know, it may take years, but, you know, it's happening and it continues to grow.
Well, yeah. And I remember when Anonymous powered out with their first video.
Yeah, me too.
And I was working as a critic, and I remember just being blown away by that video.
Yeah, it was cool.
I thought, what the hell is this? This is really a masterstroke. It's genius.
Yeah.
Because you had Anonymous, this polymorphous, pervasive, everywhere, nowhere, sending a public message to the Church of Scientology. And I tell you, that was just startling.
Right.
And amazing. It was really... It showed the power of Anonymous,
yeah,
the power of the Internet. Now, what you did in a different way was amazing, because it reached into the psyche of Scientologists, right into the soul, and it communicated using the Scientology language. It gave specific names. You knew people, former executives.
Oh, yeah.
You know, you, Jefferson Hawkins, Marty Rathbun, Mike Rinder, Karen De La Carrière, you just go down the list, you know, and Hayden and Lucy James. And I mean, this just was amazing. So it allowed a lot of former members of the church to constellate, especially Sea Org members.
Did
OSA try to attack your website or you?
Oh, yeah. I've had plenty of people come and, you know, but mainly in the form of informants where suddenly somebody contacts me and they're like, suddenly want to be my new BFF, you know, best friend for life. I never heard of this guy. He wants to come over to my house and, oh yeah, he's doing something just like me. They think, you know, like, oh, he's also starting a, there was some joker here in Dallas that they, I'm sure they put here, who said he was also, you know, fighting cults, and he was a copywriter, and which was bullshit. He was not a copywriter, I found out. And, you know, and I mean, they tried to, they had this guy even move over to near where I live from his, where he was living, which was about 10 miles away. He got a job, like, apparently like a few blocks away, and then said, hey, you know, I'm working right over where you live, you know. I just ignored him, and he sent me a bunch of stuff and tried to get me involved in stuff, which I just ignored all of that. So they've tried, but, you know, the thing is, you know, my first couple of years in the church, I actually worked for the GO, and my job at one point was to infiltrate the deprogrammers and this whole what was called the anti-religious movement arm in Dallas.
Wow.
Yeah.
So you're an old Guardian's Office crim?
Yeah, well, I was a volunteer at the time. Wow. I was just Scientologist, but I was
Let's diverge for a minute. So you were Guardian's Office, and you were sent in to infiltrate deprogrammers?
Yeah, because what happened was I joined the church, and my mother went to go find out about what is Scientology. She went to the library, and she saw this whole bunch of stuff that had been put there by ARM, the anti-religious movement. And they said I was being hypnotized and all this stuff, and she got just completely freaked out.
God.
I mean, completely freaked out.
Well, sure, she's your mom.
Yeah, and so she called in. That resulted in, you know, my whole family got freaked out, and they called in a deprogrammer from California and
oh,
and paid him $500 to come here and deprogram me along with – and my uncle, I didn't even know it, but he got some priest here in Dallas, an Episcopal priest, to come over and take part in it. It was like – that guy was a goddamn demon. I mean, he was so creepy.
Yeah.
The deprogrammer was way better than him. He was actually scary, the priest, you know, this preacher, Episcopal preacher here in Dallas.
I can imagine.
So,
yeah.
Huh, well, creepy, man. But anyway, so I got all that. And the reason they did all that is because I wanted to join staff. I didn't want to go to, you know, I wasn't finding anything in college that interested me. And and so I wanted to do something to make a difference, you know. I wanted to, you know, there's, besides money, there's also meaning. You know, meaning, you know, if you come to the end of your life and your life has no meaning, guess what? You're freaking trouble. Meaning, I think, is more important than money. You know, I mean, what's money? You know, nothing. In the end, people always, they feel this great big vacuum in their lives. You know, what's that vacuum? It's the lack of meaning, because they never did anything to help anybody else, or they're not doing anything to help, or their life, you know, didn't really have any purpose. They didn't really make any impact. So that's what I wanted to have. By the time I got to be, you know, an old man, I wanted to be able to look back and go, I made a difference. I helped people. And, you know, I grew up in the turbulent 60s and the 70s when, you know, it was just one catastrophe after another between Watergate and Vietnam. I mean, you know, drugs and all this crazy insanity that was going on.
Yeah.
It's like, you know what, somebody's going to have to pull finger and do something about the state of the world. Otherwise, we're not going to have one. The Cold War? I mean, nuclear, you know, bombs? I mean, it was in, you know, Dr. Strangelove, the world. It was crazy. So I thought, you know what? I'd rather do something about the world and leave it a better place than, you know, continue on here at Southern Methodist University and get my degree in business and then go out there and be a wealthy businessman and get a nice house somewhere, you know, and wind, and that's it. So I found, you know, some – seemed to be workable, a lot of workable stuff in Scientology. And so I wanted to join staff, and that resulted in the deprogrammer coming out. So I had to leave staff, because at that time you couldn't be on staff, and this connection was not allowed. It had been canceled, and you literally were not allowed to disconnect from your parents or anybody else. So I had to handle my parents. And so part of that was to infiltrate the ARM movement in Dallas. And I found out about, you know, planned deprogrammings and reported up on that so something could be done. And I met, you know, the local people who were in charge of ARM. And then my job was to break up their communication lines, in other words. So to do that, we used Scientology in reverse. So you would actually, start rumors about somebody, or say, oh, you know, I met somebody that knew you just the other day. But then you wouldn't tell them who it was. You just leave them like that and drive people crazy. You know, who's he talking to? You know, whatever you could think of, you know, to break up their communication lines. And part of that also was to get my mom involved in doing something else other than fighting cults. And so I researched and I decided, you know what? She used to be interested in painting pictures. And so I'll get her back interested in painting again. So I started encouraging her. Hey, mom, you ought to start painting again. That kind of thing. And she did. She started painting again, and I got her more and more interested in that, or, you know, she did anyway, and she started painting. She took up painting and then started playing down, you know, the whole anti-cult thing. So I know how they work. So what are their key things they're going to try to do to me when I start Scientology Cult? Is they're going to, one, try to, you know, break up any of my communication lines. That's number one. Number two, they're going to try to repurpose me, what I call repurposing. I'm just going to get you involved in something else other than exposing the crimes, abuse, and criminality of David Miscavige and the Church of Scientology. So,
and let me interject there, because this is what a line that the Church of Scientology runs on everyone through OSA.
Yeah.
Don't you have anything better to do?
Oh yeah, I had people come to me, like they sent an operative named Yale Sherlock out to my house, and she, you know, I thought she was an old friend of mine for marketing, but she was, you know, we're sitting there. We go out to dinner and she's saying, you know, I just want to make money. You know, I just want to make money, Steve. I just want to make, you know, tons of money and be able to buy whatever I want. And she's like basically trying to encourage me, see, like, yeah, you know, get rich, make a lot of money. That's what she was trying to do, obviously, because I found out she was working with Tommy Davis in the end.
Oh, man.
So it was the whole little scam they ran on me. But in the end, I saw through it and didn't bite on the worm.
But here's my, Steve, what I wanted to say relative to what you're saying about them trying to handle you.
Yeah.
My answer, because I was recently, someone very important recently asked me, don't you have anything better to do?
Right. Oh, yeah, I had people like that too.
And I recognized the line, and I said that freedom of religion in America is so very important.
Yeah.
And that's why religious tax exemption exists, so that people of faith, you know, can have tax-free dollars to spend.
Right.
And that's how it's been. It's enshrined in the Constitution and, you know, in Treasury regulations, everything.
Right.
And religious tax exemption doesn't belong to a bunch of glib con artists.
Right.
And it really goes to the very integrity of the IRS, freedom of religion, to have a bunch of glib con artists called the Church of Scientology abusing tax exemption.
Yeah.
So I think protecting the Constitution, freedom of religion in America, is a very important thing that I do as an American citizen. So I do plenty of things, and this is one of a very important thing to expose fraud, dishonesty. Really, the Church of Scientology creates such enormous human suffering, misery, bankruptcy.
It does.
And so, yes, this is something very important to do.
Right.
For my particular life and karma, call it what you will.
Yeah.
And so that's really the answer. But the Church will try to invalidate people. Don't you have anything better to do?
Oh, yeah. They'll try to say, you know, like I had people contact me on the phone just out of the blue, like people I haven't spoken to in 10 years. And all of a sudden, they're suddenly, hey, how you doing? You know, wow. Well, that's great. So what are you doing? Like, apparently they know nothing about me. Then all of a sudden, out of the blue, they'd say something like, well, you know, I just don't want to get in any mudslinging.
Yeah.
Crappy is talking about, asshole. And then I would just nail their ass to the wall because I know exactly what's going on. And
I had someone contact me to try to get me to take down the Scientology 990Ts from my website.
Right.
This person said, you know, any Scientologist still in the church who reads these, you know, your website, ScientologyMoneyProject.com, will think it's all black PR. It would be better if it were at a neutral website.
Right, sure.
And my answer was, look, they're public documents. Take them and you post them at a neutral website. They're staying here.
Right.
And now with this attack on Karen's website, and what, just by way of comparing notes for our listeners, the Office of Special Affairs very much tries to infiltrate,
yeah,
neutralize, invalidate.
Right.
And that's just part of their operation, is to try to shut down N-Theta online, yeah. Handle it, contain it.
Yeah, any way they can. And another way they've also will try that is what I call love bombing. Say, you know, I just one guy in particular, and he knows who he is. But he contacted me repeatedly and would say stuff like, you know, I'm just into loving everybody, and everybody's my friend. I don't care if they're in the church or not in the church, or, you know, and ultimately we just, you know, we have to come all together, you know, and that's the only time you can solve things, is when we're all really on the same side, you know, and it's really all about love.
Yeah. It's all about love. And by the way, why don't you take down your website?
Yeah, right. And we're going to keep on abusing people and destroying human lives and creating and people dying of cancer and leukemia and everything else because we're you know, so overtly suppressing them, and we're just going to love, but we're going to solve it all through love. Sorry, bullshit.
Yes.
No, we're not. Yeah, we're going to solve it by exposing what's going on here.
Yeah, you are the man. I mean, that is correct.
Right.
It's we do things our way, and the church can keep doing things their way, which doesn't work.
Right.
Nevertheless.
Well, you know, one last thing I wanted to mention, because you had asked me about it, was this odd thing about the tools to help. Can I mention this part?
Oh, please, okay. Yeah.
Well, this, you know, people always say, why did people even get into Scientology if it's so bad, right? And that's the obvious question. You know, I mean, you don't find people going down and signing up for the local, you know, mafia or the local, you know, something you know is terrible. So why do they do it with the Church of Scientology? And the weird thing is because it actually has a lot of good stuff in it, but it also has a lot of evil stuff. And what happens is people get involved and they find the good stuff first because the evil stuff isn't promoted. And they think, wow, man, this is it. I found it. At which point, everything else gets like this blanket, okay. Or at least I'm not gonna argue with it because this stuff is so right. You know, they can't imagine that it would also be evil at the same time. There would be some evil part of it, right? Like a split personality.
Yeah.
And so they think, well, I don't know. You know, what do I know? Maybe this is right, or maybe he knows better. You know, I don't want to, you know. So there's the honey part that attracts the bees, which is actually useful and good. And then there's the vicious part. And a lot of the vicious part, in fact, you know, didn't even start with David Miscavige. I mean, he is a sociopath, and he needs to be held accountable for his actions, because I don't care whether he's got, you know, a stone tablet from the Almighty that says it's okay for him to do X, Y, and Z. If it's a criminal action, it's a criminal action, and he has to be held accountable. And anybody else that supports that kind of thing. You know what I mean?
Certainly.
You murdered somebody, you need to go to jail, and you can't tell the judge and the jury, well, you know, hey, L. Ron Hubbard told me to do it. Sorry, that's not an excuse.
No. So, any more than Jesus or Allah told me to do it.
Right, exactly. But nevertheless, I mean, you know, there's been a consistent, you know, I'd say furor, you know, about L. Ron Hubbard's role in all this. And the actual fact, when you actually study up on him, on his life and his actual deeds, I mean, you know, he apparently said numerous times that he you know, if you want to get rich, start a religion. And, you know, it's too many people seem to have heard him say that. And there's too much in the way of supporting evidence for it that actually shows, I think that's why he did start it in the first place. And, you know, his motives were not all pure. There's a lot of people that start things for bad reasons. And sometimes, though, the things that they start turn out to be, there actually is good in them. And, you know, certainly you can't find any paragon of virtue that ever started anything. I mean, every single person had, you know, hidden stuff in his life, and he was committing adultery left and right or whatever, or he was, you know, having kids by other women, you know, on the side, and he was involved in stuff that wasn't perfect. But in Hubbard's case, I mean, it goes a little bit beyond that to where there was some actual, you know, pretty vicious stuff. And, you know, this whole thing of fair gaming people, which is basically, if you cross me, then the gloves are off. I'll do everything in my power to destroy you, and I'll never forget, and I'll keep after you until I destroy you and we even the score. That came out of Hubbard's own psyche, and he put that into the church. And so, So there's a lot of, you know, question about, even if you got rid of Miscavige, you know, would it fix the church? Well, no, of course not. Just getting rid of Miscavige is step one. It isn't the solution. It's just step one. It's like the first thing you've got that got to happen. And there's still be a ton of work after that. But the problem is you have, you know, there was a great movie and it was called, it's one of my favorite sci-fi movies of all time called The Forbidden Planet. You ever seen it?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's 1958, the year I was born. And it was an excellent movie because it's in color. But it's all about, it's a psychological based drama about this, you know, this ancient race that had the ability to, they built a machine that could materialize anything. So if you just thought, hey, I want a glass of water, bing, a glass of water would appear in your hand. Or if you wanted $1 million, boom, $1 million would appear, bing, in the floor, right? And they all got destroyed because what happened is their id, you know, the evil psycho part of your mind that's animalistic and you know, vicious, that actually also was able to access this machine unbeknownst to the people who were using it. And so they all, through their ids, conceived their worst nightmares and were devoured and destroyed by all these monsters which the machine made appear one night.
Yeah, I remember.
That's what the movie's about. And Hubbard kind of did the same thing. The same thing happened with him. He started out for a bad reason, found something incredibly good, and did something. And you know, he spent the next 30 years or so of his life working pretty much full time. I mean, people that know him and worked with him said he was the hardest working person they ever met. And these were people who also saw the bad side of Hubbard and the mean side, and they said, you know, he did things and that were just undeniably beneficial to people. And that's why, you know, some people, you know, say, well, I'm, you know, I still use a lot of Scientology. They're talking about the good parts of it. But simultaneously, he instilled in this creation these horrific attributes, like, I'm, you know, if anybody criticizes Hubbard or Scientology, we're never going to forget. We're going to come after you and destroy you no matter what. We'll be relentless.
Well, yeah, exactly. Yeah, there is revenge at the heart of it.
Right.
I was talking to a journalist once, and I said, look, here's an analogy. It may be imperfect, but Henry Ford invented the assembly line.
Yeah.
And he allowed us to build cars, you know, make cars cheaper and accessible. Now, Henry Ford was a vicious anti-Semite. He was a Jew-hating son of a bitch. That's established. He really supported Hitler before World War II.
Right.
Now, I drive a car. Does that mean I support Henry Ford's anti-Semitism? Absolutely not.
Right.
It's not even connected.
Right.
And I try to explain to the journalist, look, some people find certain usable things in Scientology, and they left the church because they don't support Hubbard's evil side. Within the expanse of human consciousness, there is both good and evil.
Right.
And for whatever Hubbard, and we're not debating Scientology here for our listeners, that's a separate show or a series of shows. Whatever efficacy certain people find, and certain people find Scientology appealing, whatever efficacy or usefulness they find, Hubbard's evil, malicious stuff that was incorporated into the organization remains. And so in my experience, people have suffered that malice that's incorporated into the church.
Yeah.
And they've left and they keep what they find workable and usable, and they leave the church because the organization itself is vicious, vindictive. It's a out of control machine that must be cruel and abusive,
yes,
stingy.
Yeah.
And so the church is falling apart. And to your point, Steve, the Church of Scientology is inherently self-destructive. Things that are not good to do, it does, and it's destroying itself, and it's doing it to itself.
No question about that.
And it's astonishing to me for a group that claims to have tremendous spiritual insight to not get it, that it's destroying itself. It's not psychs, wogs, suppressive persons, degraded beings, one-ones. I mean, this is all stuff they mocked up.
Yeah,
the church is doing it to itself by its own actions.
Right.
If
well, a lot.
And I,
Yeah, but a lot of the church's history is actually false. You know, like Hubbard made it up. For example, he said he went on all these great. He was, you know, a member of the Explorers Club, which he was, but he really got there by kind of fraudulent means. You know, he says he had three different expeditions. You know, but in actual fact, when you read what happened with quote expeditions, I mean, one of them was a vacation. Actually, two of them were simply vacations that both went awry, and nothing ever happened. Like, he didn't produce one single, you know, beneficial thing from this expedition. And in other words, he turned a vacation and called it an expedition to get a bunch of free gear so he could, you know, take a motorboat up to Alaska, which he...
Yeah, that was the radio thing, radio navigation.
So he was doing this false stuff from the beginning, even long before Dianetics and Scientology came along. He was creating this false persona about L. Ron Hubbard as this great adventurer explorer, which he was using to sell his fiction books. So when then Dianetics took off, well, he already had created this big, huge lie about himself. And you know, he was a womanizer in the early, you know, foundations. He always attributes those to, because it was the communists were in there, or because, they didn't properly deliver services. You know, they just got embroiled in other stuff. Well, hey, Hubbard was the one that was running up tens of thousands of dollars in bills and living like a king at the time. And in fact, in 1950, when the first people who responded to Dianetics wanted to get trained, he trained them up. You know how much the training cost? $500. $500, that's a lot of money. That's a third of a car back then. Average car cost $1,500. Today, the average car costs, you know, that's the equivalent of like, what, $5,000 today?
Sure. And you know, Steve, the stuff you're talking about, one of the best books out there is Barefaced Messiah by Russell Miller.
I finished reading recently, and it just shows that, you know what, that is the kind of thing that is evidence that his effort was to basically get rich, because instead, you know, we're in Dianetics. He said, hey, this is a planetary thing. We got to reach out to. The only way to prevent mankind from destroying itself, right, which through nuclear war or some other insanity, is to make one person sane, you know, one at a time, to make people sane one by one, and which actually kind of makes sense. That would be the only way you could really do it. But when it comes to actually implementing that, he's charging $500 a head. That doesn't make sense.
And this is a great place to stop, because we're at about the hour mark, a little over it. And I'd love to have you back on the show, because, Steve, ultimately, in one sense, Scientology is a big marketing campaign. And in the context of the 1950s, Hubbard wrote a book that just went viral, top bestseller list, because people did want answers to nuclear war. And you know, other things that were going on back then, McCarthyism, and, you know. So the marketing of Scientology, what I like to do in our next show is talk about the use of language in Scientology, because it uses a distinctive form of superlativity, the use of superlatives, hyperbole, cosmic themes. I'd like to really, one, go back to what we didn't finish this hour, the brain drain out of Scientology.
Yeah.
But also, I'd like to really talk to you as a writer about Scientology's very unique use of language and how it's morphed or degraded into Sherman speak in recent years.
Yeah.
I'd like to compare notes on that, because I don't think there's enough focus on the use of language, on a very particular type of language. And since you wrote a lot of the language, I think it'd be a great show for people who are interested in writing and the use of propaganda, the use of marketing. And I think in the 1950s, that was certainly Hubbard's genius. His dark genius was how to market and sell.
Right. Well, you know, marketing is involved in everything. And marketing has a collection of tools by which you can analyze things and get things done, take things apart and figure out how to fix things. And really nothing else but marketing can – that's its value, you know, when it's used properly. It's not, you know, taking a bunch of crap and making it popular. It's helping people understand what something really is, because that's the real marketing. That's how I'm using it. I'm helping people understand what Scientology really is. You know, when we talk about, it's full of abuse, criminality, corruption. In addition, it's got some good things. but, you know, it's not really usable unless at some point we pry those things apart and separate the wheat from the chaff, and nobody's done that yet.
Yeah, distinguish the unlike things. Well, let's begin on that in our next show. Steve Hall, it's been a pleasure having you on the show. The time just flew by.
Yes, it did.
Steve Hall, his website, ScientologyCult.com. Very interesting, content rich. Karen and I post our YouTube videos there because we believe so very much in Steve and his work. Steve, great having you on for Surviving Scientology Radio. This is Jeffrey Augustine. We're available online at survivingscientologyradio.com. And as always, we'll be in very good touch.
Thank you.